Sunday Papers on Off the Ball.
Yeah, great to have you with us, as usual, on the Sunday Papers. I'll run you through the headlines first of all. Plenty of reaction to Ireland's win in Rome yesterday. Sunday Times, first of all, has Tadhg Byrne. Man of the moment, Tadhg Byrne, by the way. He's generally being talked about now, even in Lions terms, within the Sunday Times. Byrne leads the way as Ireland scores 6 tries to thrash Italy. Romp in Rome is the headline. Beside that, there is strife in France. Minister threatens France withdrawal. So it seems the government are not best pleased with the COVID outbreak in the French camp, and more specifically with how it happened. So the Minister for Sport there says, we asked for an investigation from the FFR and Bernard Laporte, who's the president. He himself came to see us before the tournament to present the protocol. He told us the bubble was going to be strictly respected. However, we can see this is not what's happened. I'm waiting for him to come and explain to us what has happened. And if nothing happens, if we don't look into this chain of events and they don't explain to us how it all happened, then the authorization that has been given to play the tournament can be withdrawn. And she was talking about the players out having waffles in Rome. I don't think it was written into the protocol that the players could go out and eat waffles. If they went out to eat waffles, then they had to be retested when they re-entered the bubble. Fabien Galthié has had to deny all sorts of accusations that he broke protocol personally. So that's brewing over in France. The investigation is due to be concluded next week, and the French government were reluctant to go out with the Six Nations anyway, it seems. So there may well be consequences down the line. The Mail then, Roman holiday. Ireland 48, Italy 10. Ireland find their mojo at last, but it's all too easy against abject Italians. We have the Sunday World next. It's Ole's fire sale. United play Chelsea, of course, this afternoon. And there's a talk, according to Kevin Palmer here, of a fire sale at the end of the season. Solskjaer hoping to get rid of De Gea, Paul Pogba, Jesse Lingard, Anthony Martial, all expected to leave. And Jadon Sancho was top of Solskjaer's list. Sunday Independent then, again, it's the rugby yesterday. Step in right direction is the headline. And beneath that, Deignan, Michael Deignan, interesting exchange at Congress over the weekend. Deignan calls for equity in clash over GEA funding. So Michael Deignan, now of course chair of the Offaly County Board, was talking about how for counties like Offaly, I think our ability to survive, never mind compete again at the highest level, is based on an urgent equalisation of funding. I just think this whole discussion, he's talking about the funding going to the Dubs, has been, I wouldn't say swept under the carpet, but times have changed. And then later on, John Horan, the outgoing president, said in response, I must say I found that a bit insulting, considering in my time in Leinster, Dublin's budget in coaching was reduced by €200,000, and that money was dispersed amongst the other counties. The Observer, they're going with the rugby, but not the events in Rome, more principality. See in red, Wales clinch triple crown, but referee and rank and discipline cost Farrell's England dearly. We have the Sunday People. This is Man City's run of 20 wins in a row. 20 wins in a row, and as if they aren't good enough, City want £100 million Haaland. That's a frightening thought, really, isn't it? As Aguero goes, if Haaland suddenly pitches up to lead Man City's line. Star Sport then, 20s plenty. This is, again, is Pep Guardiola's winning run. One of Pep's greatest achievements is what he says about it. Pep here in the Sun then, similarly saying the run is like a title all on its own. In fairness, it's a pretty ridiculous run. And the two Johnnies. This is Johnny Sexton comparing Craig Casey to Johnny Wilkinson, saying he always thought he'd be last off the field himself, Johnny Sexton at training, but Craig Casey's at a whole other level. So that's where we are on the front pages. Delighted to say we have Cliodhna O'Connor with us, All-Ireland winner with the Dublin Footballers, now involved with the Dublin Hurlers, of course, and journalist, broadcaster extraordinaire. If he's not on any podcast you turn on, sound out the alarm bells. Where is Johnny Ward? Check in with his family. How you both doing?
Good, Joe.
Great, great.
I mentioned Congress, Cliodhna. So the sin bin is the other issue in hurling. Are we happy to see this come in, or were you encouraging the Dublin defenders to haul down any player in on goal?
Oh, absolutely. Pull them down. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's one of those things, isn't it, Joe? But with the football, that we've had the same thing with the mark that's been talk about the countdown clock. And so anytime there's any of these significant rule changes, you have a nice polarized opinion in the GAA community. So, like, from my perspective, as looking at the physical side of the game or the athlete preparation, it doesn't make any difference to my job as such. But you can see the motivation for why people want to bring it in, and it's in a trial basis. So, like any other rule, they'll see how it works, and whether it improves the game, or I'm sure we'll have some controversial. It'll be used at sometimes, and there'll be some controversial decisions, which will give everybody a good bit of meat to talk about whether it's worthwhile or not. But until it's in proper championship action, you never really know. I don't think.
I felt it was very much needed. Particularly last summer, the amount of cynical fouling was off the charts. I mean, not a weekend was going by without somebody in on goal and defender deliberately pulling down player in on goal. That just couldn't continue. It was embarrassing for the game.
Yeah, a lot of people have talked about the cynical fouling. So, I mean, and a lot of people who would admit that is, or suggest that is in the game, and then say, well, I'm not sure if this is the right solution. But if you think that there's a problem in the game, you have to try something rather than just waiting and seeing. And I mean, the argument that it's too much for the referee, you know, they have to decide, was it inside the line, and then was it deliberate, and was it a clear goal, was it an obvious chance on goal? Like, to be honest with you, the same decision-making process is involved with the penalty as it was previously. So, obviously, the referees have to. There's some sort of subjectivity to their decision-making. They're in the moment. Obviously, it's a difficult decision to make, but they're referees and they're highly skilled at it. So that's not a reason not to do it, I don't think.
Rugby on the front pages and within the opening pages of a lot of the sports sections, the general consensus, Johnny, is that Ireland were a bit better than they have been, but Italy were so terrible that it's hard to read too much into it.
Exactly, Joe. Yeah, I guess kind of split between the kind of praise of Ireland and how bad Italy were, and lots of praise for Johnny Sexton. And considering, I suppose, the criticism that he's had to deal with, he is getting on a bit. His performance was absolutely massive. And I think that's probably one of the Sexton's perfection silences doubters. That's Peter O'Reilly in the page 2 of the Sunday Times. But there's a lot of talk about, you know, I guess how bad Italy were. Basically the fact that they gifted Ireland a victory that was never going to be in doubt at all. And Neil Francis in the Sunday Independent as well talks about that, as well as a very moving reference to Gary Halpin, and just speaks about the fact that Baird and Casey, proof of green shoots and facile victory. But there was definitely, I suppose, the papers generally, there isn't a, I suppose the issue of the coaching and where Ireland are going is still kind of very much up in the air. And people are, the journalists writing this morning are kind of like, we need to see more games. But they're definitely positives from the players who came in for Ireland, and Sexton's performance, the fact they hit 48 points as well. And it really is hard to believe when you think about it. Like, I'm confident that Ireland would have beaten Wales if they hadn't lost Peter O'Mahony. And all of a sudden, Wales have won their 3 games. Hmm. It's staggering the way it's kind of worked out for them, and hasn't worked out for Andy Farrell. But the papers are kind of... looking at the ratings the Ireland players got in the Sunday Times, generally 6, 7, 8 out of 10, but nobody kind of getting ahead of themselves.
No. Tommy Conlon says they didn't leave Rome with their reputation greatly enhanced, but that's hardly their fault. They did what they had to do. All verdicts for the moment must remain on hold. Above that, as you mentioned, Neil Francis. I think a lot of people were waiting to see what Neil Francis would say about his great friend Gary Halpin, who passed away during the week. They were incredibly close, and it's a very moving piece, very short. I mean, under the circumstances, you could imagine Neil could do a 2-page spread on Gary Halpin, but he recalls to 2019, summer's day, he was just out of the shower and he had a missed call from Gary Halpin. I rang him back. Are you free? Yeah, I'll call up. I'd taken one bite out of my toast when the doorbell rang. It couldn't be him. He only rang 10 minutes ago. There was a large shadow blocking out the sun at my front door. Who else could it be? Nobody could do impromptu or seat of the pants better than Gary. We went out into the back garden. When we finished talking, it was dark. What a glorious waste of a day. I brought him back to the front door. We had a big man hug and I kissed him on the forehead. We had practiced our goodbyes from Pulp Fiction. That's how we said goodbye. And he talks about Gary was racked by insecurity. While it never consumed him, he did need reassurance. He did need approval. He did need acceptance. His wife, Carol, was such a brilliant foil and a barometer for him. And she smoothed out any anxieties he had. Carol made him tick. Sometimes we had to make him talk. And he finishes up by saying, we had talked half a dozen times before I wrote last week's piece about our night out in Chicago with Leon Spinks, which was a great piece, by the way, if you didn't catch it last week. It is unsettling that 2 days after it was published, he would pass away. He goes to his place of rest, possibly with the knowledge that everybody he met did in fact love him. The bard said to weep is to make less the depth of grief. I'm not sure I can agree with that. I am heartbroken. So very moving, very sad. 55 years of age, Gary Halpin, when he passed away suddenly during the week. And in many ways, Cliona, of all the rugby pieces, that's the part that will stick with you the longest, I suspect.
Yeah, I mean, you said it yourself, it's just so personal, isn't it? And you can really see the depth of their relationship. I mean, to know about somebody's, I mean, the relationship that he had with his wife and his insecurity and his need for reassurance. And I mean, it is really, really moving. As you said, for such a short piece, it seems to get to the heart of their relationship. And that bit about a glorious waste of a day. Mm. I'm sure isn't that what everybody feels when someone passes away or they miss somebody? You'd love to waste a day with them. So there's this longing for just shooting the breeze and not doing anything particular, just to have that person around.
Yes, we underestimate those glorious wastes of days, Johnny.
Absolutely, yeah. It's, you know, it's if the lockdown has done one thing, it's kind of I suppose, as Patrick Kavanagh said, to wallow in the habitual and the banal. And, you know, you certainly miss those kind of carefree days of just meeting your friends. And it's a beautiful piece by Neil Francis. I have to say, the lovely line about she made him tick, we met up, we sometimes had to make him talk. And, appreciate these days when they're there, because we'll all emerge out of this sometime this year and hopefully reassess things in life. And, probably be reminded that there is beauty in the habitual and the banal.
Yeah, well, condolences again to all concerned. I can only imagine how difficult it's been. Something totally different. It's in the Sunday Times, Michael Foley, Dennis Walsh. It's in the Sunday Independent. We touched on it last week in the paper review. Trouble brewing in Clare GAA, to say the least. So, in effect, to sum up what's going on here, and Mick Foley and Dennis Walsh cover it really well, I think, in the Sunday Times. There is an unhappiness with the Clare County Board in the county. Pat Fitzgerald, father of Davy, has been the main man there for 30 odd years, and there is a sense that things are not going in the right direction. And so there was a proposal that an independent group should come in and assess everything going on in Clare GAA. That proposal came from outside of the county board, and so this was to be discussed at Tuesday's meeting. And ultimately what's been agreed is that this group can come in and look at things, but the board, the county board, must have representation on the board, on this new group. And so that's kind of where we are. But it's almost in the detail that Mick Foley and Dennis Walsh unearthed that you get a sense of, well, unhappiness, to say the least, and a tension between Brian Lowen, the manager, and the county board. So for instance, some examples here. The devil's in the detail. There's a reoccurring awkwardness, they say, between the Clare County Board and its flagship team. Within weeks of Brian Lowen's appointment as manager in October 2019, problems surfaced. In December, he chased the board for money owed to the team's strength and conditioning coach. He ended up paying the money from his own pocket 4 days before Christmas. In mid-January, Lowen was reimbursed. In the early months of last year, Lowen reportedly sent 29 emails to County Secretary Pat Fitzgerald about team affairs, each of which went unanswered. A meeting was arranged to thrash out this breakdown in communication. In this arena, there was no shortage of back and forth. At the heart of Fitzgerald's response was his insistence that the work was being done regardless of the emails. Gaps continued to appear. Away league match against Wexford, targeted as a key game by the Clare management. They stayed in a hotel in Waterford the night before. The bill, though, was not settled on their departure. Lowen took it upon himself to chase the payment with a series of calls and emails. The post-match meal not covered either. The hotel manager discreetly pursued Lowen to the team bus, politely explained the situation. Lowen settled the bill on his credit card. A few days later, he was reimbursed. The county secretary had not been present at the meal. And then something which jumped out to me as absolutely extraordinary. For the past few years, the team had been renting a 10-year-old GPS tracking system. It comprised of 18 pods that could not produce real-time data during matches or training sessions and cost about €18,000 a year. So Lohan and his management team sourced a state-of-the-art system similar to the one used by Liverpool and the German national soccer team. It had, instead of the 18 pods, it had 40 pods, a laptop, an iPad, heart monitors, and it delivered real-time data. And this cost €3,000 a year less than the 18 grand the Clare County Board were shelling out for the lesser quality data. And as well as that, it was €3,000 a year less for 3 years, after which Clare would own the equipment, as opposed to the 10 years of paying out for the lesser quality GPS tracking system. When that proposal was brought to the board, however, they were slow to break ties with the previous supplier. The deal was done, but Clare management could not understand the delay. And on it goes. There's something not right here, Johnny.
It really is remarkable. You know, I'd kind of only half been following this. And again, a great example of proper journalism in a newspaper where, you know, they call it a special report, Michael Foley and Dennis Walsh. Do you know what? The thing that stuck for me, Joe, from the piece was that that hotel manager when they stayed at the hotel in Waterford. So you can just imagine the hotel manager, and it's described how he discreetly pursued Lohan to the team bus. Can you imagine, like, a man of the profile of Brian Lohan in a big, big job in Hurling, basically being pursued by, probably an embarrassed hotel manager to explain that, you know, he's going to have to foot up, pay the bill here and pay it on his credit card. And as I was reading, you know, these various things, I don't think you mentioned the fact then as well that after the lockdown, the nothing changed about the mood. When Clare resumed training, they started at Carhartt and the 5 million centre of excellence. And according to those present, the pitch was like a meadow and completely unsuitable for hurling. They listed all, you know, when we speculate in recent days after Jonathan Hill was interviewed about why Damien Duff left the FAI setup. Can you imagine Damien Duff dealing with some of the stuff that Brian Lohan has had to deal with here? I mean, we're not talking about a poor Hurling County, and that's not to mention the football side of it. Clare has a very proud football half of the GA as well. I'm just amazed that Brian actually persevered with all the stuff he had to deal with. You know, more than once having to come up with money to basically pay the money that hadn't been paid. And you mentioned in the issue about the stats sports thing and then the pitch. And then it goes on. This issue as well, just the whole Clare thing, as well as the coverage of the strategic planners. In the Sunday Times, page 4, Fitzgerald's rates bill clash may prove his toughest yet. And this is about Davy Fitzgerald. This is an article by Mark Tai. And then it goes on to detail the abuse that the Fitzgerald family and his father, Pat, 75, have suffered on social media. And it references this Facebook page of 13,000 followers. So there's an awful lot going on in Clare at the moment. Mm. And, you know, you would wonder, he's been in the, as you mentioned, he's been there 30-odd years, Pat Fitzgerald. His relationship with Brian Lohan is referenced in the piece. I think he spoke about it on local radio. He spoke to Clare Echo, just before Christmas. I would say I'm getting on reasonably okay with Brian Lohan. I have treated him with the courtesy he deserves, and I think, to be fair to him, he's done the same to me. There's a view out there that I wouldn't be supporting team management, and that is the opposite. But clearly, if you read the piece, I don't know Pat Fitzgerald, I don't know Brian Lohan, and I'm not here to talk about either of them, but Brian Lohan has had to put up with an awful lot, and it's no surprise that Clare had a pretty lame championship.
Mm. It's dysfunctional, Cliona, we can say that much.
Yeah, it appears to be, for sure. To be honest with you, Joe, like I hate when I see these sorts of pieces or coverage, because like it's so frustrating. And having been in various scenarios over the years involved with GAA, and big ones and small ones, but as the organisation is getting bigger, and let's say Clare GAA, the football and the hurling, it's a big organisation, and it's run in a local manner. And I don't mean that in a derogatory sense. I mean the community is so small, and it's a small group of people. Like Pat Fitzgerald has been there for years and years, and Davey's so ingrained, and Brian Lohan has such a heritage in hurling and all of that. So it's a small community, and when things go toxic, they really go toxic. And then you've got this a group of players in the middle of it who, it's not like all this stuff is happening at a board level and they can get on with this. They're talking about arriving at a pitch and it being like a meadow or the gates being locked. So the ripple effect of some of these arguments gets to the players very, very quickly. Stuff like their, as you mentioned, their equipment and all of that. So it's one of the big challenges, I think, in GAA and county boards and all codes. Mm. When things go wrong, it can have such a wide-reaching effect for personal lives and for performance. I mean, if the Fitzgeralds are talking about the abuse, if Davey is sitting on the Late Late Show talking about the abuse he's gotten, regardless of whether he's made mistakes or not, if it's that bad, yeah, like that's a massive issue and a massive toll on a family.
Yeah, I'm not sure what's going on here. That GPS system, that's odd. That needs to be explained, I would think. When you're talking about a local organisation and local people putting money in, that just seems like a strange situation to have gone on for so long. And Gerlach Nan was in the Irish Daily Star during the week, and they mentioned it here in the Sunday Times, where he said, of this situation now where there's going to be a group set up to really, you know, strategically look at where the county board is and are things, you know, being done in accordance with best practice. Gerlach Nan's take on the county board going along with this. He was saying the county board are not brave going with this. They just sensed that the tide had turned against them. The game was up. This was a fight the county board couldn't afford to lose, and it's the first time they've backed down. This will give courage to everybody, but watch as the board tries to delay this new body at every turn and to ensure change comes at a pedestrian pace. Now, I'm sure the board will say that won't be their intention and won't happen, but that's the opinion of Gerlach Nan. He went on to describe Clare GAA as firmly in the grasp of the Fitzgeralds. He says, Pat Fitzgerald has lost touch with what is required to keep Clare competitive. Again, very harsh criticism from Gerlach Nan. I'm sure Pat Fitzgerald would deny that. He was asked, by the way, about how long he's going to be employed for, or what the terms of his employment are. He was asked this in a recent board meeting by the Aerog delegate Rory Hickey in December. And Pat Fitzgerald said, well, my first contract was in 2009 and the second one was in 2016. That'll answer your question. You're an intelligent guy. So a fairly pithy response. I'm presuming he means there he'll be in the job until 2023 and we'll see what happens then. So I don't know. Well, let's see what happens with this new group which have been put in place to sort everything out and have a look into everything. Gerlach Nan reckons they'll be stopped at every turn. We said it last week, it's never dull, or it's rarely dull in Clare. A lot of big characters there. I think we've lost Johnny Ward. We'll get him back in just a second. Cliona, where do you want to go next? We have Sean Flanagan, we've Tiger Woods, there was a piece on athletics, there was Peter O'Reilly and Kevin O'Brien. I know you picked out a couple of these.
Yeah, maybe athletics.
Carl Dennehy here in the Sunday Independent.
Yeah,
we did a piece with Carl during the week, and the short version was, well, it was about the super spikes, it was a big part of the discussion. Yeah. The new spikes are allowing times to be shattered. But in the main, the jumping off point was that lots of Irish athletes are doing very well of late, like the 800 metres women's runners are off the charts at the moment, four of them in the world's top 20. And so Carl is trying to explain what's going on at the moment. It turns out it's a pretty simple answer in some ways.
Yeah, well, I'm sure the athletes would maybe disagree, but in some ways, yeah, he's just describing their structures have been better, they've been training better, they've over lockdown and with everything quietening in their lives, they just had a lot of time to train and train really well and a lot of time to rest. And I mean, it's such a, if you talk about athletes all the time, we talk about amateur athletes or professional amateur athletes, this idea of trying to earn a living and compete at the same time or manage various demands in your daily life. But they seem to all have benefited from a really focused period to just train and rest and train and rest, and it's happening at a great time for them. And I suppose that sense of all pushing each other on, I mean, in the space of a couple of days, records were broken and then they were broken again, and somebody was a record holder for maybe a couple of hours. So I think everybody bouncing off each other has helped the athletics community, and as you said, especially those 800 meter runners. But even like, they talk about Phelan Kelly, who is, what do they call it? The Dublin Track Club. So that's his group that he runs. And he's talking about what they're doing. And his mantra or principle is just consistency in miles when you're talking about endurance sport. And he's saying that, you know, everyone wants to train like Rocky Balboa for 8 or 10 weeks, but that's not real conditioning. For the body to be truly hardened, it's continuous training. It's very simple, but it's hard to do that day in, day out, all year. And I think maybe the last, as we said, the last year has given people more time to just harden their bodies and get really good quality training in without any distractions. So, there's a really positive vibe around Irish athletics at the minute on numerous fronts. Mm. And I think the most important bit of this piece was towards the end, the last couple of columns, they're talking about what they're doing for coaches. Because if you're talking about a sustainable long-term approach, upskilling and supporting Irish coaches really is the way to go if you want to keep talent in the country and develop a good culture. And one of the things that stuck out to me was Noelle Morrissey. She is Kira Neville's coach. And it said 4 years ago, Morrissey recognised she didn't know enough to bring gifted junior sprinter Kira Neville to the top level. So she reached out to Stephen Maguire, a Strabane native who was then overseeing the sprints program in British Athletics. Maguire put her in touch with Michael Afilica, I think is how you pronounce it, who's a coach to string of international medalists, who has since been her mentor. So, like, it just says a lot about Noelle's personality. First of all, she's a good relationship with this young sprinter. Everything's going well. Knows that maybe, do you know what, I don't have the knowledge I need. This girl has a lot of talent and I would like to continue the journey, but let's go and reach out. And think about it. We're obsessed with our team sports in Ireland and our GAA and rugby and all of that. But think about the act of one coach reaching out to the British coach and saying, listen, I don't know enough. And having the humility to do that, and then getting a mentor, and things have seemed to go from strength to strength in that. I think that sort of culture in athletics is something we could all learn from.
Yeah. European indoors are on this week. That's part of the hook as well. And as you said, a lot of Irish athletes in good form. Carl Denny makes the point, you know, about the rest period that they've all had, either working from home or even not working at all, and suddenly they can train properly. Carl Dennehy writes, it's an age-old problem. Most on the Irish team next weekend at the European Indoors, he means, are in an awkward position. They're gifted enough to make the Olympics, but not fast enough to get meaningful support. And they're aware that most modern workplaces don't offer the leeway required to fully chase their dream. And that's the tricky part. Interesting idea from Dave Sweeney. So he's the National Field Events Coordinator for Athletics Ireland. So Dave Sweeney from Athletics Ireland, he was talking about the German model where over there, athletes are offered careers in public service, and that allows them to do low-intensity part-time work and then to focus on their training as well. We should start investigating links with the military, defence forces, or the Gardaí, or even on a corporate basis where they put athletes in part-time work and take the pressure off financially. Might be an interesting idea. So
it's hard not to think of the GAA there, Joe, isn't it? Because it was an interesting study done, I think, by the GPA in recent years. The players who find themselves in jobs that they may not necessarily have taken, but for the fact that they really would have suited their intercounty career, and maybe became, like, for example, a teacher because it would have suited the hours and so forth, but then post-retirement kind of wonder, could I have done something differently in life? But it's definitely interesting. I found the athletic stories of late really, really heartwarming. And Sinead Hassan had a lovely piece about Nadia Power in the Irish Independent yesterday, and she's a fantastic story. You know, I have to say, I'd never heard of her up until maybe 6 weeks ago. I'm not really big into athletics, but I looked into her background, and like her dad's coming from Sudan and is probably more Irish in terms of he speaks more of the Irish language than the three of us maybe put together. He's just put, like, he's had a big influence in the Irish language, and her mother's from Kilkenny, but she's just been like really working hard during lockdown, and absolutely, like, she battered her own record by a couple of seconds over 800 meters there, I think, last week. And she's just this, I think, like, Irish athletics is going to take on a different kind of hue, I guess, when you have these sons and daughters of immigrants who've come over here, and they've had such a huge impact on the football fields. But athletics can only be a matter of time, and I think she's a marvelous example of where Irish athletics might be going. And it's fascinating an article by Cahill in terms of lockdown. And even just this morning, I, as much as it's probably the most beautiful morning of the year, I was just went up to get the papers and really struck by the amount of people out running. And I think lockdown has been great for some people who've probably started taking up some exercise that they've just continued on because they got addicted to it. And it's striking how many people are out running and cycling and so forth in Dublin these days.
Yeah, no, it sure is. That said, I'm starting to lose my wick. There are a couple of there are joggers out there who think the footpath is a treadmill. Like, honestly, it's like out of my way. This panting, coming around the corner, and it's just like just because you're running does not mean you own the footpath. I just have to get that off my chest. It's driving me ballistic. It's insane. They do think they're on a treadmill.
Dave McSavage had a great Instagram story about cyclists, and like I kind of started cycling last year. And I remember reading this article by a guy a letter to the editor in the Irish Times, where he was on about pseudo racing cyclists taking over the cycling lane by kind of sea point there. So if you're going, you can imagine this fella on his leisurely cycle, and these lads are just bombing by him, like, you know, swapping in and out of lanes. And David McSavage's piece was about this guy who was cycling behind him and like loudly roared at him, "Get out of my way!" And he's like, "You know, you didn't. You know, I'm on the road here because I'm trying to get from A to B. Like, don't let me get in the way of your training." And he compared it to like meeting a boxer in a pub, and a boxer is just like, "I'm just going to punch in front of me, and if you get in my way, you get in my way." And so they probably, Dave McSavage is very, very annoyed about it, but you do see them. There are a lot of runners taking over. All right.
Yeah. Anyway, look, that's a minor gripe. Although Roy Keane had a good Instagram post yesterday. It was him in his cycling gear. He had a helmet on. He said, "I'll wear the helmet, but if you see me in Lycra, run me over." He's warming
Roy
to
Keane's
Instagram.
Roy Keane's reinvention on Instagram.
Oh, listen, it's the most surreal thing. By the way, just a quick mention. It's a short enough piece, but I think people will be interested. By Paul Rowan, Sunday Times, page 13. FAI unsure if Dublin will host Euro 2020 matches. So I'm presuming here Jonathan Hill, the new CEO of the FAI, he did some media during the week for the first time, and I'm guessing there was a Sunday section, and that's why we're getting some extra stuff here. So basically what's happening on the Euro 2020 front, Jonathan Hill was saying, is that UEFA, they want crowds, basically. UEFA want crowds. And they have now told the FAI that the games will be moved should there be no supporters allowed in. And they've set a deadline of early April for the association and the 11 other host cities to give a commitment on attendances. Dublin's difficulties, writes Paul Rowan, have been exacerbated by the fact that England, which is already hosting the semi-finals and the final at Wembley, is now offering to host the whole tournament with fans present and full capacities anticipated for the latter part of the tournament under Boris Johnson's roadmap out of lockdown. By the way, I mean, Johnson's roadmap out of lockdown is so much more optimistic than everyone else's. Like, I feel like they're hurtling towards something. Jeez, I'll be first to applaud him in 6 months if he was right, but it just seems too good to be true at times. Anyway, Jonathan Hill said,
"Wouldn't you nearly laud Micheál Martin for like he's been anything but populist on this because they've been so bleak about everything. I actually almost admire him. Fianna Fáil are struggling in the polls, but Micheál Martin has been very pragmatic, whereas Boris is kind of like, all good news is good news, and let's just kind of steamroll into this without possibly knowing the consequences." And I envy what's going on in the UK with vaccines and all that, I actually do have a lot of sympathy for our government because they're in a terrible situation.
Ah, completely. I have no problem with the very sober, very cautious approach they're taking, because what happened in early January cost lives. You know, that's the brutal truth. And they got it wrong pre-Christmas. I mean, opening up pubs and everything 4th of December and then the explosion that happened. It was a bad idea, and I think they've been burnt by it, and they're not going to make that mistake again. And fair enough, that's not to mention the madness we saw a couple of streets over yesterday here.
Yeah, Micheál Martin, the comment that probably is attributed to him, love, and he said, you know, you can forget about the takeaway points. Like, he probably does regret saying things like that because, you know, what they're doing for the country. And let's be honest, like, he had no idea how you would deal with something like this, and he's kind of learning on the job, as they all are. They've all made mistakes, but it's not doing them any favours in the poll, and I think he's just doing it for the betterment of the country, you know?
Yeah. So anyway, Hill is saying, basically, UEFA want answers. It's fair to say UEFA are pushing forward, and they have real people who bought tickets, and I don't know. I mean, given Micheál Martin's caution, I think there's a fair chance these games in Dublin, these four games, are not going to happen.
Yeah, he, John Anthony Hill does, he speaks about, like, quite positively about how, you know, the Aviva Stadium, we can cater for, you know, safe crowds and so forth. But one other interesting aspect of that article, as you mentioned, Joe, the same old rules applying these kind of press conferences, despite the nature of the press conferences nowadays, we have our daily papers and then we have our Sunday papers, something I always found a bit idiosyncratic of these press conferences. But it brings up, Hill has promised that the FAI will take any necessary action against plans by the boxing promoter MTK, co-founded by Daniel Kinahan, to become football agent. So that's interesting that that was mentioned as well.
Yeah, that jumped out. He was pretty strong in that. He was talking about, you know, we've all these rules and regulations and face-to-face interviews, Garda vetting, he mentioned, and he said they're very committed to that, so we'll see. And
One other thing, if I could just bring from that article, which kind of segues into another, the issue of having a betting partner, obviously the FAI is still looking for a sponsor, was brought up, and Jonathan Hill spoke about this, that it was felt that you know, it'd be better if the host, or the FAI's actual I suppose main sponsor wasn't a betting partner, which is fine. But if you go to page 3 then of the business post, the FAI has asked for a share of the betting tax to help clear $70 million debt pile. This is a very interesting article by Aaron Rogan. Aaron Rogan was formerly of the Times Ireland edition and then moved on to the business post. But he does a lot of coverage of the betting industry and just that sort of stuff in general. But this is definitely interesting for racing, because racing has effectively been getting all money from betting proceeds since time immemorial. And this is kind of goes back to time when basically people bet on horses and they didn't really bet on anything else. But it talks about the junior minister Jack Chambers having met with the FAI. The FAI argued that because of the proportion of bets made on football in Ireland, the sport should benefit from the tax, and it comes after the association has already had its funding increased to deal with legacy financial issues, which led to the resignation of John Delaney. And it references that John Delaney brought up this issue himself back in, I think it was 2012. And I actually asked a couple of people in the betting industry this morning, roughly what percentage of bets in Ireland would be football versus racing. What would you think, Joe? Which would be more popular?
God, I have no idea.
Cliodhna?
I haven't a clue, actually.
I didn't really know the answer either, but it's roughly, they're roughly on a par, and football is basically going only one way. So there are basically as many bets placed in football, according to my mates in the gambling industry, as racing, but the money doesn't go to football, it goes to racing. So racing's going to have a big concern here, because like I don't see how anyone could argue that the 20 quid that I placed on Chelsea and Man United today, the proceeds of that should go to the prize money of a winner of a maiden hurdle in Clonmel. It just doesn't add up anymore. So that will have to be dealt with. And obviously the gambling regulator is coming into force later this year, and it's going to be interesting times in terms of funding of the sport and sport in general.
One other point out of Hill, Cliodhna, I know this caught your eye as well, on the subject of parity for women internationals when it comes to match fees. Hill said he discussed the matter with Vera Powell, the women's manager. She recognises there won't be parity of actual financial amounts in the short term because of the disparity in the monies that go into the two sides of the game, particularly in relation to prize money for the men's game and the women's game. I'll work with Vera, as well as working with the men, in relation to have a sensible approach to match fees. I don't know how many internationals we're talking about a year, 10 tops, and I don't think the match fees are exorbitant. So I would have thought there's a way, it would have been a really positive step forward. I understand why the Chelsea women's team is not getting paid the same as the Chelsea men's team, but when it comes to international match fees, they aren't life-changing amounts and would make a huge difference to the female players in this country. I would have thought that's something the FAI could have looked at, but he's saying no for now.
Yeah, you would hope that when they're talking about the short term and the long term, that's like that would be such a, to me, an easy small win for him to do that in terms of the grand scheme of things, and it would mean a lot to those players in terms of even just how they're perceived by their own governing body, by the FAI. And I think at this point, and this sort of ties in with, there's an interview with Louise Quinn in the Mail. Mm. And she's talking about how brilliant it was. Well, one of the things she's talking about, how brilliant it was that just Vera is staying on until 2023. She's talking about having different managers and all that chopping and changing, and the fact that somebody is now committing and there's a bit of continuity. She's talking about other players like herself and Niamh Fahey and Katie McCabe upskilling and getting their coaching badges. And so what you're seeing now, what it seems like you're seeing, is the current crop of international players recognising, all right, there's a bit of momentum, there's a shift in the sand, and let's continue performing as footballers, but also try and improve our own game by getting involved in coaching, by giving back, all of that sort of stuff. And if you've got that goodwill from your players, something as simple as, do you know what, we're going to value your effort to play for your country the same as we're going to value the men's effort to play for their country on that day. We're going to see them as equal. That just is such a boost for players in their scenario. And I think, Hill seems like a very straight-talking, genuine, kind of no messing around type of guy in terms of the bits you've seen in the media so far. And he talks about sensible approaches and all of that. But from a PR perspective, from an easy win, I think that is just too easy to step over that one or to miss that opportunity. Yes, you're not going to say, okay, they're going to be equal in the next 6 months or the next 2 years, but let's try and start with the basics.
That Louise Quinn article is definitely worth a read in the Mail as well. She talks about her time. She's obviously playing in Fiorentina at the moment. She's obviously just gone on about how Florence is an amazing city. But what interested me was her time in Sweden and the role that she played at the club she was at, whose name I'm slightly struggling, Eskilstuna, I think. And they went from basically having like 100 people at their games to having to expand the stadium there because the women's team became so big and they're bigger than the men's team. Really good story. And I've had Louise on a couple of times on Off the Ball when I've been on, and she's a really good talker. And just the role that she's played in terms of moving around, she could be an example to some of the men that she wasn't insistent on playing in England. She's now played in like, what, three different countries in Europe. And I think generally women's sport is at a really interesting time because media coverage has improved exponentially. And I think there's a great, there's a lot more respect for us in general in the media, and there's a lot more respect for us in terms of people watching it. And very interesting times for the women's game. And I think they have an FAI now that is definitely going to listen to them. Mm.
The hook for this piece, by the way, is that Louise Quinn and Fiorentina are in Champions League action on Wednesday. They play Man City in the last 16. So it was a good time for Mark Gallagher to check in. Interesting, some of the cultural norms apply to both sexes. So she was saying just the diving over in Italy. She's like, I know it's a cliche and it's what everyone says, but that's what
they've
experienced.
She was like, they're doing it in the Premier, they're doing it in England as well. So I think she was kind of, she probably had said it and then she said, oh, I better actually backtrack a little bit here. So she said, no, it's actually everyone is doing this. But I was thinking of these Italian women just going down and basically emulating the stereotype.
Yeah, there was definitely a backtracking. She was like, oh no, everyone's doing it. But I mean, Italians are seriously doing it.
But was it interesting her perspective then for her own self saying what she has to do as a defender, she has to really perfect her tackle. So even though she thinks, okay, they're jumping all over the place, but it shows like her commitment to the defensive craft of this makes me have to be a better defender because to deal with all this stuff. Mm.
Do you know as well, it was funny when, like, back in the days when we used to play AstroTurf, I would play out in Ringsend, but the odd day you might get like a couple of lads would be joining you from where they basically their game was called off or whatever it was. And when you do play a few games with lads from different nationalities, it's absolutely fascinating. They just play differently. Their touch is different. The way what they do with the ball is different. And it's like, it must be fascinating for her at that level then to be going over there and playing these guys and having to adapt her game.
You're just bashing, bashing up the field, are you?
Are you comparing your five-a-side to her moving around to various countries?
It's football culture, is clean. It stands for a reason, you know. When you play the guys from like Latin America or Croatia, they just play differently.
It's just
much cooler.
They love dribbling with the ball with a rollover the whole time. There's this like samba flow, and meanwhile we're just bashing it 30 yards and chasing it, you know.
We're trying to narrow the gap, but I'm interested to know like what what women's football is going to do in Italy. Italy is a different society to over here, and it's I think certainly in terms of GAA, the support that Gaelic Games and Camogie has gotten and the crowds and all that, it's really revolutionary times for women's sport in Ireland. And those athletes we mentioned as well, the likes of Nadia Power, are certainly playing their part. I think it's if you're a young kid now and you're a young girl in Ireland who wants to get into sport, you've massive opportunities for you, and I hope that'll grow in the next 10 or 20 years because I think it'll explode.
Oh, I think it's happening. I was walking through, it's a long time ago. I remember walking through St. Anne's near where I live last summer, and it was just me and my wife were walking through, and all the pitches were taken up with training. It was like a Thursday evening or something, and it was just remarkable. Every second pitch was a female team, and we were both commenting that was not, that was just not the case 20 years ago. Just wasn't. Even, is it Louise who's talking about it? Yeah, like Louise started with the Blessington boys under sixes. I think that was the norm. Like yeah. Louise is 30. I think when she was under sixes, you were starting with the boys team. And weirdly, I mean, there's a wider conversation there because Vera Powell is of the opinion the best players on the team now did play with boys growing up, and you can see that, and to a certain age that's good for their development, but it is extraordinary. I don't know, Cliodhna, are you noticing it? Maybe, I mean, it's the kind of thing you're probably keeping an eye out for, maybe more than I am sometimes, but it did strike me that even I was like, my God, this is brilliant. Every second pitch it's a female team now, and I just know that was not the case when I was growing up.
Oh, it's the volume of young girls starting in sport is increasing every year. I know local clubs in where I'm in Portmarnock, their nursery, it's equal now, boys and girls, which is hundreds every Saturday morning. Before, you'd have at under 10 level, you might have four boys team and one girls team. Now it's pretty much the same, not far off it.
Yeah,
so
it's great.
The introduction to sport is definitely equal now, I would say, or pretty close in terms of opportunities to get involved.
Do you know what's intriguing as well? So Galway United have brought Lisa Fallon in. So Galway United have been my club, and Lisa Fallon has come in and joined John Caulfield. And do you think that'll happen much more, Cliodhna, that, you know, you'll have female coaches who will join basically men's teams? Like, you're going to go down that route yourself, and will it become, because it is a barrier to overcome as well, I guess.
Well, I just think it's a bit like anything. There's more female coaches now. There's a bigger critical mass at coaching at development level, and you'll see that translating as more people get involved. More people will invariably rise to the top. But up to date, not many have been following that pathway all the way up to the elite level. But that will change just by the nature of more people being involved and seeing it as a viable thing to do, or people having an interest in actually following that path. And you see now more and more speaking about my own domain, ex-female inter-county players getting involved in coaching. Remember, ladies football's only what are we, 40, 45 years old. So you have generations of people now who are ex-players. Go back 20 years, you didn't have as many ex-players to get involved. So it's definitely happening.
Yeah, for sure. So time is coming against us. I mean, you guys have picked out a couple of other stories, including an interview with the jockey, Sean Flanagan. There was a piece with Kevin O'Brien, the cricketer, 10-year anniversary of Ireland beating England in the cricket this Tuesday. There was a Saturday panel on it yesterday, actually, looking back on it. And Peter O'Reilly chats to Kevin O'Brien. Johnny, I think you mentioned that Kevin O'Brien piece.
Yeah, it's hard to believe that, like, obviously that is 10 years ago, but he's some great lines in it, Peter O'Reilly, and actually, to be fair, the Times is really excellent articles. I think the David Walsh's on Tiger Woods is a brilliant read as well. So he talks about, Peter O'Reilly talks about, obviously, it's next Tuesday marks the 10th anniversary of the day for sporting upsets by Irish teams. It eclipses the Giant Stadium in 1994, and he goes, I may not be politically correct, it may not be politically correct to say, but for this armchair viewer, victory was sweetened by the fact Ireland's hero had been the most Irish-looking and Irish-sounding player on the team. Okay, so his red hair had been dyed pink to support the Irish Cancer Society, but you get the idea. And he goes on about the reaction then to that victory. Some of the messages he received were precious. President Mary McAleese called to say he reminded her of Cú Chulainn, the heroic warrior from Celtic mythology. And it basically just kind of discusses where cricket has gone from then, and we're talking about girls getting into sport at a young age. It talks about the rise in cricket played in Ireland. It's a pretty exponential rise. I've lost the stat here, but it definitely had a big effect. And I do remember that time, it was 10 years ago, but people who would never watch cricket were getting intrigued by it, and obviously beating the old enemy was something else at the time. But it's a really nice article, and obviously discusses where cricket has to go in Ireland. And I thought this was nice as well. England looked jaded after a winter on tour, but they were gracious losers. In his autobiography, Andrew Strauss wrote, "Things were going nice and smoothly until O'Brien came in and chanced his arm. And before we knew it, we had 100 off 50 balls. It was one of the greatest examples of clean hitting that I've seen. By the end, we didn't know where to bowl to him. Chanced his arm? Fair." And O'Brien replies, "Massively fair." So it was just one of these sporting events. Probably happened slightly off the cuff, and it worked.
Yeah, it sure did. You mentioned the Tiger pieces. I mean, for me, that was the story of the week in some ways. Dermot Leese writing about Tiger Woods, David Walsh writing about Tiger Woods. You know, Gleese says, and you can tell with a heavy heart, "There is a strong possibility we'll never see Tiger Woods play competitive golf again. For those of us of a certain age, it's all desperately sad, not least for the fact he's been a dominant figure for a large part of our lives." And, you know, as Dermot Gleese so often can, he tells you something you don't know. So he remembers first seeing Woods at Royal Porthcawl, September 1995, the Walker Cup, which is the amateur version of the Ryder Cup. And he remembers Woods having to withdraw from the final practice session because of an upset stomach, because accustomed to a diet of junk food, young Eldrick's digestive system rebelled against the more delicate offerings of the pre-match banquet, a bit like a motor car tuned to low-octane petrol, stubbornly refusing to function on premium grade. And he just charts his Woods's career and remembers Augusta, who had kind of turned its back on Woods after the scandal broke, then celebrating his win in 2019 and saying it was one of the most amazing weeks in our history. And Gleese says, "In a situation created for hyperbole, the butler's cabin," he means, "this was in fact no more than the cold truth." And he says, "So we wish Woods a full recovery from the horrors of last Tuesday, and that when tempted to make more demands on his amazing sporting instincts, we accept that he's already given enough. Let's simply look instead at the prospect of he and his son Charlie casually trading shots together in happier times down the road, just as they did to our delight on television last December when their world was a very different place." And,
On that, Joe, the whole crash and all that, speaking the next day at the Concession Golf Club in Florida, Rory McIlroy gently offered us a perspective. He's not Superman, he said. This is David Walsh's article. But yeah. If you were to freeze, like, the moment that Tiger Woods is in that crash, are you as a golf fan going to take the position that we're in now, where he survives with his life intact and he will live to fight another day but won't be able to play golf at a professional level? Absolutely you would. And it's, you know, as much as you can be sad that it's over, this could have been so much worse. Yeah. I mean, and just reading David Walsh's article, just the upbringing that he had, I thought there were some really interesting kind of anecdotes. Back then, Tiger was the Adam of Earl Woods' labourers. Earl had been a US Army officer and done two tours of duty in South Vietnam. He raised his boy to be an unapologetic, even cruel winner, to appreciate the difference between beating an opponent and crushing him, and to always strive for the latter. "We came, we saw, we conquered. We got the F out of town," was how Earl described the modus operandi to those early years. Tiger was the boy soldier, quick to learn, eager to please. And I thought this was a brilliant line. It was Michael Bamberger in his excellent book, Second Life of Tiger Woods.
Yeah, great book.
"Whatever character's defects he might have had, they were useful on Sunday afternoons." I thought that was brilliant. And if ever a piece could finish in a nice way, quoting Thomas Kinsler in Merv in February, Thomas Kinsler, I studied him in school. He's still alive and would have lived in Inchy Core. And I remember as a kid in school being intrigued that a poet I was reading was actually alive, but he's still alive all these years later. "I fold my towel with what grace I can, not young and not renewable, but man, and Tiger will live to fight another day." And I think that's what matters, not the fact that he mightn't be playing golf.
No, totally agree. I mean, very fortunate to survive seems to be the word. I think Woods is the most interesting sports person on the planet, actually. The most complex, the hardest to read, and yet there's so many brilliant pieces of work on him. That Second Life of Tiger Woods book is great. The Jeff Benedict one's great. There's a new documentary about him. And he's on such a journey. I mean, his childhood, to say it was unorthodox is an understatement, and there was damage down the line as a result. But then he's gone through so much, Woods, and has come out the other end adjusted, and there's a touch of humility about him now. McIlroy, where he says, when he sees me now, McIlroy says, when he sees me, he asks, how's your mum, how's your dad? Is that something he would have done 15 years ago? I don't know. Like, there has been this metamorphosis when it comes to Woods in the last 10 years, which is unbelievable.
And he's David Watt spoke about the night, and the infamous night in June 2017, and the officers treated him sympathetically, and though Woods was out of it, they remained respectful. After they handcuffed him, he asked if they could loosen the right one a bit. After they did, he said, thank you so much. In this moment of excruciating vulnerability, Woods showed something of himself, the man for so long obscured by the athlete. It's a really, really lovely story, as you say. It's just, I mean, you could write 10 books on him and you still wouldn't have gotten to the bottom of him.
No. Well, look, he's alive, that's the main thing, but the golfing career looks like it's probably over, you would think, which is the sad news. Would you have been into Woods, Cliodhna, fascinated by him, interested in him, or just vaguely aware? Golf, I know, is not for everybody.
Yeah, but I mean, if you're interested in sport, how are you not interested in Tiger Woods? And maybe there's something that we can all remember if we're commenting on athletes, like that there's, I'm glad that everything that's written today and during the week, that there's a real compassion about it. Mm. It's nearly like everyone is saying, Tiger, you've been great, you've given us so much, and we're glad you're alive, and don't worry about the golf anymore, and just be happy and be with your family. That seems to be the general sentiment. And with hindsight, we look at the time when maybe he was gruff and he wouldn't talk to anybody in the courses, but now everyone seems to realise, well, you can see why he was like that. You just described him a few minutes ago, Johnny, like the boy soldier, that maybe he entered the golf world with that mentality of, I'm going to, in order to conquer this, I have to steel myself and I have to be this person. And we've seen an evolution in the human being and in how he is as he presents himself as a person, as an athlete. So I think any athlete in any sport with such a long career, you're going to go through changes. And sometimes you need to be one person to be successful. And other times, after you've done it, after you've reached such pinnacles that he did, you're able to ease off a little bit and let a bit of your own personality out, or your perspective just changes. Mm. You have kids, you go through some challenging times and you realise, you know what, I don't need to do that anymore. But I'm glad that, and it's unfortunate maybe that a car crash had to bring that out in people. Maybe it was there already, but I'm glad there's a lot of compassion for him as a human.
Yeah, no, I think it's been there the last couple of years for sure, and the celebration when he won the Masters in 19, copper fastened that in some ways. Before we go, and we are recording this Sunday morning into Sunday afternoon, just, Johnny, to acknowledge, I know obviously racing is very much your beat, that Gordon Elliott has tweeted to say that he is cooperating fully with the Irish Horse Racing Regulatory Board following a photograph which has circulated on social media. He says, I'm aware of a photo in circulation. The IHRB have been in contact with me regarding this photo, and I will be cooperating fully with their investigation. We've seen the photo. It's not a good photo. And I suppose the authenticity of the photo has to be established, first of all, and we can only deal in facts. And the news cycle just has to have a bit of patience when it comes to these matters. So let's establish the facts around the photo. But this could potentially be incredibly serious for Gordon Elliott. He doesn't, know, in his tweet, deny anything about the photo or comment on the photo, just that he's cooperating fully with the investigation. This has the potential to be very, very serious indeed for him.
Yeah, I don't know, Joe, would you call it like the best and worst of social media? Because an image like this, which can't be verified and could be completely doctored, I don't know anything really about the image, and you can speculate as to the veracity of it or otherwise, just appears on like a slew of WhatsApp messages yesterday, comes up on Twitter and is shared on Twitter, and you know, there's no really vetting or checking in place for something like this. Unfortunately, I was gone to Twitter. I'm off Twitter now, but I went on Twitter last night to see what was going on, and I'm aware of a photo
in circulation on social media. The IHRB has been in contact with me regarding this vote, and I will be cooperating fully with their investigation. That didn't really put me at ease, I have to say, and I don't know, like you, I don't know that what's going on with this. I do know that it's the front of the RTE's sports website this morning, and it's basically their front page story, and it's been in the Daily Mail, and let's hope that this can be solved, because I would go as far as to say is this would be one of the most damaging things if it turned out to be true, that has happened to racing in an awful long time. And I just hope it's not true, and I hope Gordon's name can be exonerated, because it's not a good image.
No, I see it's on the BBC Sport website now as we speak. It's an evolving story, which I'm sure we'll be coming back to, but just to acknowledge that. We're out of time. Thank you both so much, Johnny Ward. It was great having you on. Likewise, Cliodhna O'Connor. We'll talk to you again soon. Thanks very much, guys.
Thanks, Joe.
Thanks, Joe.
The Sunday Papers on Off the Ball.